Hello, we are just having a few technical difficulties. We will be with you shortly, so hang tight.
We are still working, but we are almost there.
Good afternoon, Valley City State University and friends, alumni here at VCSU. Thank you for being very patient with us as our technical difficulties, we have figured it out. My name is Angela Mirso. I am the chair of the art department here at Valley City State University, and I'm also the director of the VCSU Gallery. Welcome. This afternoon, you will get to hear a special talk by yours truly, Assistant Professor Angela Mirso, on her artwork here at VCSU. Not just at VCSU, but at my time from before coming here to Valley City State, and also during my time here. We ask also, please save your questions till the end of this talk. And if you want to learn more about any of our other artists here on campus, professors like Professor Grasha Brown or Professor Echo Ephraim, please go to the VCSU website, to the Art Department Gallery page, and you can watch their talks at any time. So without further ado, here is my artist talk. On slide two, this is a photo of myself. My primary focus in art is in drawing and painting. And I enjoy drawing and painting from when I was a wee lass till today. In the next slide, you can see a photo of just a couple of drawings I've done in the past, but my primary tools I utilize as an artist is charcoal, watercolor, acrylic, oil, pastels, brushes, pencils, erasers, Conte, scrapers, sponges, even photos, and digital manipulation. I like to observe. I like to be the person to watch what is going on. And in my next slide, I have a great influence from nature and also utilizing multiple colors, how color changes throughout seasons in nature to moments and times in our lives. And so primarily, a lot of the inspiration you will see in this talk is from nature, but also into the human figure. In my next slide, I have two quotes that have influenced me as artists. One by Edward Degas, "Art is not what you see, but what you make others see." And that's been a primary focus for my career, is I love creating, but I want others to decide what they're seeing. And the second is by one of my personal favorite artists, Wayne Thiebaud, is I'm not just interested in the pictorial aspects of the landscape, see as a pretty place and try to paint it, but in some ways to manage it, manipulate it, or see what I can turn it into. I like to change things. I want people to see the moments and times it transpires in a two-dimensional surface. And that leads to my artistic influences has been primarily into the 1950s, 1960 San Francisco Bay Area artists that I highly recommend. Do check them out, as Wayne Thiebaud was one, and also another personal favorite, Richard Diebenkorn, that I still look at to this day. In my next slide is my first piece I have of my own work, Summertime View, a watercolor made back in 2012. This was created over a period of time when I was back in St. Louis, Missouri, and I created it starting in early May of 2012, when everything in spring was still beautiful, it was luscious. But consequently, like up here in North Dakota this past year, we dealt with an extreme drought. St. Louis dealt with a drought at the same time. And so I showcased the passage of movement from the little red droplet falling off the petal of the plant to the changing of the background. It's not all luscious. It's starting to dry up. I saw that, and I wanted to re-show it to you all as showing the passage, how a few months can change what is usually nature being very beautiful and luscious to being very dried up. So taking within the process of time, showcasing in my next slide, gets into a different kind of passage of time I enjoy looking at. I enjoy looking and watching musicians play. It is one of my favorite things to go to a jazz club and watch as they're playing the bass or drum set to the horn. There's an energy musicians have just as much as any artist performs. And in this piece, the colors are a little muted, but still vibrant in the background. But the focal point draws you straight to the hands as the bass drummer is just playing to his heart content and showcasing the passage with that simple space that a person, when playing a musical instrument, is rocking to the beat and following it. The focal point is the hands. It's not the facial features, because it's the hands that make the sound of the instrument that we all love to hear, whether it's jazz to classical music. It is one of my favorite things to watch. Just as much as into my next slide, I love watching dancers. I may not dance, but watching the free-spirited of a ballet dancer jumping and giving the whisper of just a hint of color. I didn't want a lot here, but just enough that you can feel the breath of that dancer jumping as a sense of like, I just finished a performance. It is that space of time we enjoy. We appreciate when watching the other art forms perform, whether it's from dancing to theater to music. I taken this part of passage of time and tied it back into the landscape further. In my next slide is a photograph from an art residency I did a few years ago in Truth or Consequence, New Mexico. This experience of going down to a little town about a little smaller than Valley City, North Dakota, you're in the mountainscapes. You're surrounded by desert. It's right about an hour north of the border of New Mexico to Mexico. And the area around there is such a beautiful scenery, very tranquil of visiting. And even though the land is very dry, you can still see the hints of the greens in the forest around in the mountains. In my next slide, when I was there, I did portrait studies of folks I met during my residency. I focused on extreme colors, focusing in on saturating the color of the pastels of people I met on the street when walking around town, because I didn't have a car when I was down there, so I walked a lot. And I just met folks who were working out in their yards, or they were by the Rio de Grande, just working. In my next slide, I also met folks who worked in the small town who had their own businesses. This was actually a bookshop owner who had a very, almost reminded me of in Harry Potter, Dumbledore, with the whimsical of the hair, that I kind of brought it back of the hair, just that grayish tone. But I kept the bookstore being abstract in the background because I wanted the focal point to be to the facial structure of the portrait. And I took upon listening to their stories, hearing he opened up the shop down in Truth or Consequence, and just remembering he wore a green shirt that day. And I wanted to reproduce the green shirt, and I repopped it again back in the background to make a balanced composition. So even though I was still working with color and being a little gestured with my mark making, I still was investigating time and color choices. In my next slide, I kind of took away the color. It was at a time during my residency where all the artists would gather together, and we would usually sit around in a small studio room and we would just talk. And during those times, I would pull out my sketchbook, which may be about a 6 by 10 inch piece of paper, and I would bring out a pen and Sumi ink and actually do quick pen drawings of all the artists. This is one of my personal favorites, of just being able to do a quick sketch of an interaction of time that I didn't need to show it with color, but show it with the motion of ink and value. So it was important for me just to capture that moment. The artist was slowly working on weavings in the foreground, but the motion of her just kneeling down and putting something together is what captured my amazement. In my next slide, I went back to doing watercolors. While I was in New Mexico, I went from doing soft pastels, then back into watercolors. And I produced this sunset too as part of my journey when I was in New Mexico. I would climb up the same mountain, I wouldn't say mountain, but road that led to their water tower that was very steep every morning and every afternoon. You would never go during the middle of the day because it would be too extremely hot. So I'd always, when I was in New Mexico, I would get up early to watch either the sunrise or I'd watch the sunset. And that drew my inspiration for this piece, especially that seeing the clouds change from extreme violets to oranges to the hint of the sun just passing over or setting into the backdrop behind the mountainscapes, it just always took my breath away. Even after climbing up to the water tower twice a day, it was my ritual. And it gave me inspiration because I just did not stay in the studio. I walked around to see what else I could get inspiration from. In my next slide, in nature, I went out with a couple of the residents, artist residents, and we traveled to one of a dirt road in the middle of New Mexico, and I just remember seeing the vastness, and the sky was so awestruck of how the clouds. I wanted the focal point going not dead middle into the painting, but more towards the bottom. I wanted the clouds to be important because we sometimes don't appreciate enough how Mother Nature shows us the beauty inside of how clouds change to how even our landscape changes. And just keeping the very dirty, muddy red to some greenish into the landscape, that'll help balance this painting out. In my next slide, my piece went completely abstract, and that does happen in my work. I sometimes completely go from being realistic to being abstract in my work. In Southwest Maps, it dealt with the moment of time as I was passing through, walking through Truth or Consequence. I would follow almost the same path as if you were doing Google Maps and you're tracking yourself of where you're going from point A to point B. And so I just took that and I reproduced it. I let myself leave some of the circles, those lines being pure white of the paper, which a lot of times I would not. This was a new thing for me. I would usually cover everything up with paint and say it's done. This time I did not want that. I wanted the white of the paper, but then the layering of the watercolor to showcase the transparency of how, in a sense, a small town is. There's not a definite landmarks, but it's for me a personal map making to where I can remember different spots, whether it was to the small bakery they had in town, to the New Mexican restaurant to get tacos every Thursday. I enjoyed it. And after finishing this painting, I realized I wanted to go back to acrylics. And I wanted to still showcase the layering effect, like watercolor, that you can still see the transparency from the top layer to almost the bottom layer. And I wanted to do this with acrylic. And at that point, folks, I had to go do a little research. And so, in my next slide, I looked up the artist, Gerald Richter, and he is a contemporary artist, and I was more influenced by how he scraped paint off of a full-scale canvas and just showcasing the hints of color underneath, leaving a history. Which was very important for me in my own work is I'm very gestured, but I still wanted to show a little bit of history of that passage of time. So Professor Mirsodu, she goes out and buys some scrapers from the hardware store. It's not just only getting paintbrushes. You sometimes have to investigate and go, wait one second, I need to try a different tool in order to achieve what I need to achieve. So on my next slide, and most folks have seen this many times even up here at Valley City State University, Sunset of the Southwest. In this piece, I did scrape. You can barely see, but definitely up in the top, I scraped the blue paint around. I left drips. That was purpose. I wanted the drips to be there to showcase the passage of time. And just showcasing also that not everything has to be perfect. In some of my earlier works, some of them were. Starting to get, trying to be a little perfect with my mark making. But in reality, I didn't want it to be perfect, for I wanted to showcase a little bit of the time, but also the energy behind my own mark making. And so I did another travel after New Mexico. In my next slide, I went up to New York, which is a whole different, I would say, ballgame in a sense, but it wasn't in New York City. But it was in Upper State by Utica, and it's a small town, smaller than Valley City, North Dakota, which only has, it's called Leonardsville, New York, and they only have one post office and no grocery store. So it was out in the middle of nowhere in Upper State, New York. But it was the best place to visit, and I remember seeing the moon called Blue Moon, where I used soft pastels. I brought back soft pastels into my work. And the sky there, it was not as clear as up here in Valley City, but it was clear enough that I showcased the evening sky. And still kind of starting to control how I was making my marks on the canvas. It was a change. In my next slide of rolling hills, I remember seeing a lot of hills in Leonardsville and just seeing how the colors from being very not as reds and oranges to browns in New Mexico, it was more greens, violets, blues, yellow greens, and just a hint of pinks that I showcased in the soft pastel. I started to paint more, and this seems weird. Soft pastel is a dry medium. But in a sense, during this time, I was painting with them because I was taking the pastels, utilizing just my hands to paint it across, and also using a brush. So instead of just drawing it, I was painting with the tool. In my next slide, being in the small town in Leonardsville, there wasn't many streets, and so I would repeatedly go out, sit on the road, and draw from observation, watching as the sunrise, sunsets, simplifying down the road to the landscape, to the hint of the red on the buildings. It was peaceful. It was calm. It was what an artist would want. It's just a time to create. And in my next slide, it also was a farming community. So you would also see apple orchards. You would see hay bales. It was just a magical small town place just to show from going from very busy life to to a very quaint moment in time that I fully appreciated. So I did a couple acrylic paintings, and then I also, in my next slide, went back to some more soft pastels, focusing more not in the late afternoon, but more the early morning sunrises, and focusing in on the inn that they allowed us to stay at, and just how everything led up to that place. And in my next slide, even just showcasing just the evening skies, they weren't as blue, but it was still a nice purpley haze that I changed to showcase. In my next slide, I'm gonna say this is probably one of my most, I'll be honest, probably my most accomplished pieces I have made in a very long time, and even now I'm still very proud of have done this. We all get proud of pieces we have done because it's like, I can't believe I did this, and in a sense, I can. This is called Color Tones of the Upper State, and this is a watercolor, and watercolor is a very finicky medium. Sometimes you can get very mucky colors. As you can notice earlier on in this talk, some of my pieces were a little muddy, but in this piece, the painting is very saturated, but you can see the definite distinction of line that takes you to the focal point right into the third of the painting that led to one of the roads in Leonardsville that led to Parva Forest. And you can also see I repeated up at the top right is just the white of the paper. I didn't cover everything up. I left the negative space there for a reason. And I, to this day, feel very proud of this piece. At one time, I almost was going to paint over it, but I'm glad, as a few of the artists who saw it said, don't touch it. It's done. And sometimes you have to listen to your fellow artists who tell you it's done. In my next slide, I just wanted to share some of the beginning processes of how I do painting. A lot of times it's done right straight on the canvas. I sometimes, in a sense, when I paint or sometimes draw with the paintbrush. I don't use charcoal and I don't use graphite pencil. I just go right at it with the paint in hand. And I cover everything up. I don't leave any area blank. Unlike with the previous painting I just showed where it's like you left negative space. Well, a lot of times in acrylic, I go right ahead, right straight into the painting and fill up the whole canvas. Watercolor, it's a different process for me. So I have to be very careful because it can get a little murky in between. But this is the beginning process of this next slide piece that is called Cliff Drives. This is actually based upon in Illinois by Alton, Illinois. It's the Great River Road. If you've never been down there, I highly recommend take a trip. It's worth seeing because around the river road, you are right by the Mississippi River. And so you're driving on this road that is right by one of the largest rivers in the United States, and you see the cliffs that basically is the bluffs of the Mississippi. And when you're driving it, you're either seeing the muddy Mississippi, the cliffs, or you're looking directly across and you see the Missouri. And for me, this is a personal piece. Because it's a road I have taken from when I was young to even when I go back and visit, as it's a place that I enjoy visiting. And I enjoyed sharing when making this painting and experience what I have gone through. For that is a moment of time for me. In my next slide, in Illinois Fields, it's a part, I grew up more in Missouri, but I also traveled a lot in southern Illinois. And you always see different cornfields, soybean fields, and just remembering just driving through in the clouds was always an interesting part for me to look at of how the landscape changes. And at that time, my colors from visiting New Mexico and New York, I was starting to get more controlled over how saturated I wanted to show a piece. And I was kind of, in a sense, keeping some of the colors a little toned down to bring them saturated back out. But then I did another set of travelings again, which basically traveling is part of the influence into my work too. In my next slide, I went up to Michigan in Grand Rapids, and being on the shore of Lake Michigan is kind of neat. One of the things that drew my interest at that time in the passage of time was just how the water was hitting the rocks. Just seeing that repeated motion, repeated line done over and over. So I took this photo. And then in my next slide, I took a larger scale photo, which I was on the shore of Lake Michigan over on the Indiana Sand Dunes, which is in Indiana. And you can see right directly across, depending where you're standing, you can see Chicago. That day, you really couldn't see Chicago because Chicago was getting overwhelmed by a thunderstorm, which I enjoy watching as storms come in with the landscape being changed. So taking from the influences of the vastness of Lake Michigan and also into the waves, the clouds, in my next slide, it led to Waves, which was a painting I did based upon my experience up in Michigan and just watching as the water kept on coming towards you. And I put the colors being between violets, reds, greens, because if you look out at the lake, there's sometimes it's crystal clear, and other times you can see some of the dirtiness underneath. But I wanted to showcase everything coming towards you. And you can see a little bit in the background with the clouds. It's kind of faded out because the focal point I wanted you to look at was the waves. In my next slide, I kind of took from doing the waves of really saturating out the landscape, of really making it bright, of greens and the clouds stand out. During this time, I was really seeing how far I could push the colors in my paintings. I didn't want it to be murky. I wanted to see how far I could make a piece saturated. And it's especially shown into the next slide, Fire Sky, which is like, whoo! You see a dabble of marks representing the sky to the redness into the clouds, to the hot pinks, magentas, into the foreground that draws your eye coming towards you. I was very interested in saturating out color at that time. And the same into my next slide of the split path. I was seeing of how far I could push color, not time at that time, that I wanted to see how far I could go. But then, into my next slide, I traveled up north to North Dakota. And I enjoyed traveling into airplanes too, because you get to go see the vast landscape of how the farm fields and how it sometimes is different when you travel in around the December to January, where as you go from North Dakota down to Missouri, you go from very sometimes white, bluish, to semi-green, to dark brown in Missouri. I enjoy watching that transition up in the sky and having fun. with the transition of time. And I take that time of being even with Lands We Dream in my next slide of watercolor, of going back to watercolor where I was going back, layering back the colors, the tones, dreaming again and going back out to the mountains and seeing it. And in my next slide, with walking through the dark, this was made actually during the time when we were in the lockdown in 2020. And in a sense, when making this piece, there was a lot of unknowns going on. Now we know more. But at that time, as an artist, I was going through questioning, like, what's going to happen? And so I left a lot of that in the foreground and even up in the left-hand corner, not being finished because I didn't know. And so that's why I titled it Walking Through the Dark, because it's sometimes we walk through life not knowing fully what's all going to happen in front when we kind of plan out ahead, in which the landscape was still an important part to me at that time. In my next slide, I went back into studying clouds further with the clouds of the north and just seeing how North Dakota skies is vastly different from where I've been, which has been refreshing. To the points in my next slide, I've taken walks even here in town of going up to Medicine Wheel, to the nature parks, and just watching the transition of the day to night and even seasons, which we sometimes, we want time to go by so quickly. But in a sense, for me as an artist, I want you, the viewer, to slow down, to appreciate what you're seeing. In my next slides, it's kind of a starting of some new works I'm working with. Going back into some digital photography, which, yes, I am a drawer and painter, but there are times you want to experiment with other mediums. And so I went in further with photographs, taking pictures further of looking at being on top of the Rocky Mountains and looking out into the mountainscapes and seeing the sky there. To, in my next slide, standing up in North Dakota and watching a sunset of the painted skies and getting the pure saturation of the sunset that sometimes we get to see paint happening right in front of us. It doesn't have to be just the medium. It's sometimes just seeing clouds, it's seeing the changing of colors that makes us take a step back and go, oh, this is happening real time. To lastly, in my last slide, it's sometimes taking a photo when you least expect the coolest thing to happen that takes your breath away. Thank you.
All right, we're going to open it up for questions. I'm assuming you're ready for questions.
I am ready for questions.
I'm going to ask you the first question while we wait for other people to comment on either YouTube or Facebook. Would you, I was hoping you'd discuss the painting behind you a little bit, because I really liked that one as we were hanging it. And would you discuss that one a little bit? You've got, I believe it's a fox in there. I really like that one. That one's fantastic. So can you talk a little bit about that one?
Yes, this is actually, this painting behind me is a piece that's actually been commissioned, and it's for my friend, Mary Roffers. She lives in Wisconsin. She asked me to paint mountains for her because she has family in Colorado. And there's a meaning for the fox, and I'll explain that too. She did a lot of climbing in Colorado, and she did a fundraiser with the Michael J. Fox Parkinson disease. And that's why the fox is in this painting. her father has Parkinson's really bad, and she won this piece, and I wanted to give homage back of what she was challenging herself to accomplishing, which she always fundraise, and I wanted to make sure to put the fox and also put the mountainscapes out by Colorado Springs, or not Colorado Springs, Boulder, Colorado. And so I wanted to make sure to capture the essence of the mountains, but also of why this painting, because we've talked many times, and I wanted to make sure the fox was there for symbolism.
Thank you. Yeah, that's a fantastic painting. I wish I'd commissioned it for myself. It's really well done.
Thank you.
And we don't have any other comments so far, but I do have one other question that, going back to your one, the color tones of the upper state, the one that you really liked, why would you think about painting over that? You discussed painting over that painting. Were you thinking about just touching it up and changing it, or are you going to like paint completely over it altogether?
Actually, touching up. There was a part of me I was thinking was still unfinished, and I wasn't going to repaint over it, no. It was at a good stage, but it was at a point that it was like, do I need to add any more to that top right corner? And it just kept on bugging me until a couple of the other artists in residence were like, you're good, don't touch it. And when you hear people tell you, don't touch it, especially artists or even friends, it's important because they can see sometimes as artists, we sometimes overthink. It happens. And it's important to listen to others who can see when you're done, listen to them. That's probably a good piece of advice I can give to anybody listening in.
Thank you. That's a fantastic piece, too. I just questioned why you would think about touching it. You know, and I understand, too, sometimes you always think it's not quite done, it's not quite done, it's not quite done, so you always want to kind of tweak. So that's a fantastic one as well. We still don't have any other questions on either YouTube or Facebook, so we'll give it another minute or two. If people want to ask questions, by all means, do that, please.
Okay.
We do have about 20 viewers.
20 viewers, whoo.
Yes.
If you have any questions, folks, type them in. We'd love to answer.
And we will post this on YouTube to watch later, too. So just FYI, it'll be up, and I think you'll be able to watch it back on the Facebook page,
okay.
Our Facebook page as well. So.
And if you're interested in commissions, please contact me, angela.mirso@vcsu.edu. In case you're ever interested in a commission. This is a school year right now, so there may be a delay of getting work done. So if you're interested, give Elise a heads up notice. But definitely if you're interested, let me know.
Why don't you say your contact info? We don't put that up, but I do have your name up so they get the spelling, but say your contact info one more time.
Yes. angela.mirso@vcsu.edu.
Perfect. All right. We still don't have any other questions, so
any questions?
We'll call her good for that.